Hi, and welcome to the MVAC lab. I'm research intern Cindy Kocik. You've likely seen photos or videos of archaeologists digging up artifacts in the field, and perhaps been on an excavation yourself. And museums full of carefully curated artifacts can be found from small towns to big cities. But what about the steps in between? How does an artifact move from the soil to storage or exhibit space? We're going to explore part of that question today by focusing on the journey of artifacts from the field to the first steps of processing at the lab. Check the timestamps in the description box to jump to a specific section. As we uncover artifacts in the field, we put them in bags or other containers to keep all the artifacts from the same provenience or specific location together and to keep them safe. Fragile items such as plant remains, bone and antler, shell, and friable pottery may be placed in a plastic bin or a vial or wrapped in aluminum foil along with surrounding soil to stabilize them. We also specially tag or label materials that we don't want to be washed or touched to avoid contamination, such as artifacts with residue or plant or animal remains that may be sampled for radiocarbon dating. We also want to record what's coming in from the field so we can check that we have everything when it's brought to the lab. Bags, bins, and other containers used for transport are labeled with a tag with the provenience and date. One method for keeping track of materials is to assign a unique number to each bag of artifacts in the field and maintain a log of which numbers were assigned to which bags. These may be called something like lot numbers or field numbers. Logs with these numbers can be handwritten, as they were in earlier days, or they can be entered directly into a tablet or laptop. Before we carry items to the lab or pack up our field equipment, we make sure we haven't misplaced anything, like an artifact bag accidentally put in a field kit. We carefully place bags of artifacts in larger bags, buckets, or plastic bins before loading them into a vehicle. Large matrix bags with soil samples are checked for any tears or holes and loaded so they won't tip over and spill on the way to the lab. When artifacts and matrix bags arrive at the lab, we make sure nothing is missing its label or has broken. We usually set aside bags that look like they might have errors, such as provenience information that looks incorrect, so we can resolve the issue with the help of the field crew and field forms. Eventually, all materials coming in from the field will be checked against the information on field forms and against the master list of field or lot numbers, if those were used, to make sure the provenience information is correct. We also watch for anything marked as needing special treatment to make sure we handle it properly. Once they're at the lab, we want to clean the artifacts as appropriate so they can be identified, cataloged, and analyzed. We'll do that one bag at a time to avoid mixing material from different proveniences. First, we need to get supplies ready. Some artifacts can be washed. For washing, we start by filling a plastic bin with a few inches of water and add a strainer to hold the artifacts. This helps us to avoid leaving anything behind, like small bits of lithic debris. We'll also need soft toothbrushes, assorted paintbrushes, and dental and bamboo picks. With water at the ready, let's set up our cleaning station and work with some artifacts. Before we clean anything, we set out a large plastic tray or small styrofoam tray with paper towels to absorb water from the artifacts we wash. We write all the information from the bag in permanent marker on the paper towel in the upper part of the tray. We'll keep the artifact bag with the tray underneath the paper towels, but labeling the tray makes it easy to identify and also helps in case the bag gets separated from the artifacts. Now we're ready to start washing. We'll try to organize the cleaned items by material type on the tray as we go. Keep in mind that guidelines on which materials to wash, wet brush, or dry brush vary by lab, and the condition of specific materials may call for different cleaning methods or no cleaning at all. Anyone cleaning artifacts in a lab should make sure they know that lab's procedures and ask if they're unsure of how to handle a particular item. Stone flakes and tools are usually durable and can be washed in clean water with a soft toothbrush or a large paintbrush. However, we don't wash or wet brush burned rock, also called fire cracked or fire altered rock, like this example, because it tends to be powdery and fragile, and it may start to dissolve if it gets wet. Sometimes even stone tools are left unwashed if they're going to be examined for residue or traces of organic material. When washing lithics or any other material, we keep an eye on the clarity of the water. If it starts to get too dirty to clearly see what we're washing, or to actually get materials clean, we empty and refill the bin. Methods for cleaning ceramics can vary depending on the lab and the type of ceramics. Sometimes they're gently wet brushed or quickly dunked in water for cleaning to avoid the abrasion of dry brushing. Sometimes they're dry brushed instead. This avoids potential damage from wetting or from wetting then drying. We want to avoid damaging the surface and getting slips or residues wet. But on the other hand, it is important to clean the edges to view the temper and refit joining sherds. More fragile materials, such as animal bone and shell, can be carefully dry brushed. And a soft bristled paintbrush works well for that. Bamboo picks can be used to gently remove soil as well. If an item made of bone, antler, or wood is extremely fragile or soft, sometimes we use a consolidant, such as a thin solution of B72, so it doesn't fall apart. The consolidation process is irreversible, though, so we carefully weigh the pros and cons before undertaking it or any other procedure we can't undo. Plant remains, such as wood charcoal and thatch, aren't washed, but if they're enclosed in aluminum foil or a plastic bag, it can be opened to allow the remains to dry, if appropriate. In certain cases, soil can be removed with a soft, dry brush, tweezers, or a pick. We avoid handling plant remains that may be used for radiocarbon dating, so we don't contaminate them. After everything has been washed, cleaned, or unpackaged to dry, we check that nothing has been missed or left in the wash bin and place the tray on a rack to dry for at least a few days. We want everything completely dry for analysis and curation. Bagging wet artifacts encourages mold growth and isn't good for preservation. Once we're done cleaning artifacts, we put our brushes and other supplies away and empty and clean the wash bin. We're careful not to let any leftover non-cultural material, such as modern roots or pebbles, go down the drain. Instead, we'll discard those in a wastebasket. It looks like our strainer here is clear of pebbles and roots, so we can rinse it and leave it to dry. We'll do the same with the wash bin. After all the artifacts from a specific provenience have been cleaned and gathered together, we can rebag the artifacts in clean bags. We usually have one bag for the entire provenience, with different types of artifacts bagged, or for fragile artifacts, boxed, within that. This could include, for example, a bag of lithics, a bag of ceramics, and a box containing a bag of delicate mussel shell. We also hold on to the original field bag to check against the newly made bag for errors, and in case there are any questions about the provenience during analysis or writing the project report. After all that, the artifacts are ready to catalog. But cataloging artifacts and assigning acquisition numbers we use to track them by provenience here in our repository are topics for another time. After an artifact is uncovered in the field, there are some steps it must go through before it can be cataloged and shelved with the rest of the collections at the lab. Careful documentation and bagging in the field, verifying that information once the artifacts get to the lab, and cleaning and initial stabilization are important parts of the process. They set us up for success in analyzing artifacts to learn about the past and in caring for those artifacts long term. For more information, see the description box. And to further explore archaeological topics, find links to MVAC social media, and view and subscribe to our monthly e-news, check out the MVAC website. You can also donate online to support MVAC's work, including our videos. Thanks for watching.